Good morning.
Good morning.
And welcome to Sunset Hills United Presbyterian Church. It is a joy to have you here worshiping with us this 18th Sunday after Pentecost. Announcements for the benefit of the body of Christ this day. A very big thank you to everyone who put together yesterday's pancake breakfast. And I mean, like Sarah, Jane, and Luke did fry now that they were here at like O Dark 30 yesterday to set up. So thank you to them, and thank you to everyone who worked at the Harvest Festival, who set up for the Harvest Festival, ran the Harvest Festival, took down the Harvest Festival, baked for the Harvest Festival. What a blessing. And we are blessed today with some wonderful leftovers from the Harvest Festival. There will be hot dogs downstairs following worship today. And there will also be cookies from the bake sale, which I believe are half off now. So if you would like to purchase from the bake sale, it is downstairs following worship. And the proceeds made from the bake sale go to the ministries of our deacons. And so it's a great cause to support, and the food is good. This church is very gifted in baking. Flu shot clinic will take place on October 23rd. Find in your bulletin more information about how to register online for that. Also, I have two more announcements, but I'm not going to steal the thunder here. There are two individuals who would like to make these announcements. So first, Shelby, would you like to make your announcement?
Good morning. So on October 23rd, mark your Sundays to stay after and help us out. We are going to be doing a blanket making. This is something for years and years. I live in Greentree, and St. Margaret's Parish in Greentree has always done a blanket making event where everybody brings 2 yards of fleece, a print and a solid, and then you bring your good fabric scissors and you put the blankets together, you cut them, and you tie them. There's no sewing involved. It's a real easy ministry. For whatever reason, I've never been able to make it to that, but we got a flyer and Jody brought it to our mission group. And this year, all the blankets that are being made are going to be sent to the Ukraine for all the war displaced. So we decided as a mission commission that we want to make a total of 10 blankets. And once we make them, then I will deliver them to St. Margaret's on the 1st of November, where they're going to gather them all there and send them off to Ukraine. So on Sunday, October 23rd, we have enough fabric. We're going to have 10 tables set up. We're going to make 10 blankets. If you have any good fabric scissors, please bring them. We'll have a few scissors here, but everything will be laid out. Come on down while you're waiting to get your flu shot. I'm sure we'll probably have some snacks there, but we're going to cut and tie blankets that we'll be sending to Ukraine. So mark October 23rd to stay with us after worship. Thanks.
Thank you, Shelby. Taylor, you have an announcement today.
So last year, we had a big show up for Trunk or Treat for all the kids in the community. So we're doing it this year again on October 30th after church, noon to 2. We're going to be having a Trunk or Treat. So come decorate the trunks of your car, bring candy, and for all the youth, come and dress up and get some treats.
Great. Thank you, Taylor. And we're doing this from noon to 2 because it is much safer than in the evening when it's dark and little kids are running through the parking lot. So noon to 2, daylight hours on October 30th. Thanks so much. Friends, this is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Let us worship God. Let us focus on observing Christ's Sabbath and keeping it holy as we light the Christ candle. Let us pray. Come, Lord Jesus, come. Dwell among us. Be known among us. We pray that your presence would be felt, that your Holy Spirit would dance among us, amongst our hearts, our souls, and our thoughts this day, for the sake of your glory. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Please join me in the call to worship. The God of our ancestors raised Jesus from the dead. We are witnesses of those things, and so is the Holy Spirit, whom God has given to those who obey the Lord.
Thanks be to God. Amen.
day, to forgive one another. The peace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all. Let us share the peace of Christ with one another using American Sign Language. Peace be with you and also with you. This story church is to live according to what Jesus taught us. And the title, Fritz, can you read, what's the title? Remember to Love. So let's listen to what the Bible has to say for us about love today. It's often hard to remember the right thing to do. Sometimes people write something they want to remember on a sticky note. Teachers, way back in the day, they used to pin notes on children on their clothes with things that for a parent to remember to tell the grown-up. Now they probably send an email to your grown-up or a text message. This is a story about something Jesus wanted everyone to always remember. Jesus had been teaching people about who he was and what they needed to know about how to live. A person who knew a lot about laws came to Jesus and asked Jesus a question. Teacher, what is the most important commandment in all the laws we have been given? There are so many, but which one is one we should always remember and never forget? Well, Jesus was glad the legal expert had asked him this question. Jesus paused for a minute. He knew which law was the most important. It was very old, a scripture Jesus had known since he was a small boy. Oh, are you okay? All right, let's stay over here, buddy. It was a very old scripture from the book of Deuteronomy. Deuteronomy, and it was called the Shema, which means to hear or to listen. It was easy to remember because Jesus had been saying it twice a day all of his life. It was written on his heart and remembered in his head. Jesus told the expert in the law, love God with all your heart and with your ears and with your eyes and with your hands, and with every part of your body. This is the first commandment and the most important one. Jesus knew that the legal expert would know this important commandment. Then Jesus surprised him and said, there's a second one that is a lot like the first one. Remember to love other people. Oops, care for other people just like you care for yourself. Yeah. And so this week, I want you to try to remember the most important commandment in the morning, and at night, perhaps before you go to bed, say to yourself, I will love God with all my heart. Or maybe as you get onto the school bus, say to yourself, I will love God with all my heart. Or as you're walking into school, Fritz, since you're a walker, say, I will love God with all my heart. Do you think maybe we can do that this week? Yeah. Let's pray about it. Dear God, thank you so much for Jesus. Thank you so much for love and the way that the church is taught to love each other. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. All right. Miss Taylor will take you to Children's Church this morning and you'll learn more about how we love each other. Thank you so much, everyone. We are continuing our study of Acts this day using the commentary of the Reverend Dr. Willie Jennings, and we continue with Acts chapter 5, verses 18 to 24. You can follow along, read along silently in your bulletin. They arrested the apostles and put them in the common prison, but at night, an angel of the Lord opened the prison doors and brought them out and said, go and stand in the temple and speak to the people all the words of this life. And when they heard this, they entered the temple at daybreak and taught. Now the high priest came and those who were with him and called together the council and all the senate of Israel and sent to the prison to have them brought. But when the officers came, they did not find them in the prison. And they returned and reported, "We found the prison securely locked and the sentries standing at the doors, but when we opened it, we found no one inside." Now when the captain of the temple and the chief priests heard these words, they were much perplexed about them, wondering what this would come to. And someone came and told them, "The men who you put in prison are standing in the temple and teaching the people." Then the captain with the officers went and brought them, but without violence, for they were afraid of being stoned by the people. And when they brought them, they set them before the council. And the high priest questioned them, saying, "We strictly charged you not to teach in this name, yet here you have filled Jerusalem with your teaching, and you intend to bring this man's blood upon us." But Peter and the apostles answered, "We must obey God rather than men. The God of our fathers raised Jesus, whom you killed by hanging him on a tree. God exalted him at his right hand as leader and savior to give repentance to Israel and forgiveness of sins. And we are witnesses of these things. And so the Holy Spirit whom God has given to those who obey him." When they heard this, they were enraged and wanted to kill them. But a Pharisee in the council named Gamaliel, a teacher of the law, held in honor by all the people, stood up and ordered the men to be put outside for a while. And he said to them, "Men of Israel, take care what you do with these men. For before these days, Theudas arose, giving himself out to be somebody. And a number of men, about 400, joined him. But he was slain, and all who followed him were dispersed and came to nothing. After him, Judas the Galilean arose in the days of the census, and drew away some of the people after him. He also perished, and all who followed him were scattered. So in the present case, I tell you, keep away from these men and let them alone. For if this plan or this undertaking is of men, it will fail. But if it is of God, you will not be able to overthrow them. You might even be found opposing God." So they took his advice. And when they had called in the apostles, they beat them and charged them not to speak in the name of Jesus and let them go. Then they left the presence of the council, rejoicing that they were counted worthy to suffer dishonor for the name. And every day in the temple and at home, they did not cease teaching and preaching Jesus as the Christ. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Gracious and loving God, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight this day and indeed every day, our rock and our redeemer. Amen. Rare is the moment when ancient Greek is clearer than modern English. Today is one of those rare moments. Peter is coming from the mountaintop to speak to the religious authorities. Does anyone ever feel more confident in their faith than he? An angel let him out of prison last night. Who could ask for anything more in the way of a sign? Thus, Peter is confident today. "We obey God rather than man," he declares. This is his Braveheart moment, his Chariots of Fire scene, his great "I am Spartacus" declaration, "We obey God rather than men." And then the Greek. He says something that has been translated incorrectly for a few hundred years, that is translated correctly in our scripture today. Peter says to the religious authorities that Jesus was killed on the hanging tree. Not the cross, on the hanging tree. That is what the Greek says today. Jesus was killed on the hanging tree. And with the clarity of the Greek, Willie Jennings talks with us, speaks with us in his commentary about what Billie Holiday, you all know Billie Holiday, the great singer, called "Strange Fruit." A song about the 4,400
men, women, and children of color who were killed on the hanging tree in the United States between Reconstruction and World War II. A song about what has been compared to as American as apple pie, the tradition of packing up the kids, packing up a picnic, and heading out to see the corruption of justice, the destruction of human life in the name of racial superiority. They would sell postcards of photos of the lynching so that you could send them to your friends afterwards as a memento. Lynchings like the one that happened in Chester County, Pennsylvania in 1911, when a steel worker of color was taken from the hospital, lynched because someone thought they might have possibly seen him perhaps attack a security guard at the steel mill. Countless children of God killed on the hanging tree. Jesus Christ himself, here in the book of Acts, killed on the hanging tree. Now, if technology is our friend today, we're going to take a listen to Holiday Song, listening not only for this moment in history, but listening to how Jesus is like those Holiday sings of, hearing of how Jesus too was on the hanging tree.
The rare moment where ancient Greek is somehow clearer
than modern English.
And what are we, church, in 2022? To do with this text from Acts that brings to light for us so much of the pain of the past, so much of the pain experienced by our Savior. Scholars throughout the ages have made the suggestion that, well, this is a difficult passage, but perhaps we can be like Gamaliel this day. He hears about the disciples' miraculous escape from prison. He reclines as his colleagues rant over the disciples' message. They are ready to kill the disciples. Gamaliel is the non-anxious presence in the extraordinarily anxious room. Thus, when he speaks, people listen. After all, he isn't acting like a fusspot. Gamaliel is one of the most important scholars of his time. Shh, listen, what's he going to say? And oh, his words, the scholars tell us, his words are so wise. If their purpose is of human origin, it will fail, Gamaliel says. If it is from God, you will not be able to stop these men. Gamaliel is not wrong, is he? It seems wise. It has seemed wise through the centuries to follow his guidance, except Gamaliel gives his wisdom, tells them to leave these guys alone, and then as Dr. Jennings reminds us, he promptly gets the popcorn, plops into a front row seat for the disciples being whipped 40 lashes minus one. In other words, 40 lashes would kill a person, but they got 40 minus one. Gamaliel is the wise man in the lynching crowd. But my God, Gamaliel is still in the crowd. The path of Gamaliel is not a path that is going to work for us. When one of God's children hurts, all of God's children hurt. When one of God's children is suffering, all of God's children are suffering. We are not captive to the individualistic culture of I, me, mine. We are the church, a people who understand the interconnectedness of all humanity. Who is our neighbor, we ask in the Gospels? Every person we meet. Our friend, our enemy, our acquaintance, our antagonists. They are our neighbor. To quote Madeleine L'Engle, author of A Wrinkle in Time, she was also something of a theologian. And she says, we all know the beautiful imaginative concept of the butterfly effect. If a butterfly winging over the fields should be hurt, the effect would be felt in galaxies thousands of light years away. The interrelationship of all God's creation is sensitive in a way that we are just beginning to understand. If a butterfly is hurt, we are hurt. If the bell tolls, it tolls for us, end quote. So much more if a child is hungry in our Sunset Hills neighborhood. So much more if a man is unjustly imprisoned in the Allegheny County prison. So much more if a woman is diagnosed with a terminal illness at St. Clair Hospital. The pain is not theirs alone. When our neighbor hurts, we all hurt. The path that works for us is not the path of Gamaliel, because the path of Gamaliel keeps us in the crowd. That is not the path that works. The path for the church is the path of Jesus Christ, modeled for us in the work of the disciples throughout the book of Acts. Jesus models this path for the disciples. Jesus is the park ranger, if you will. And this has been a pretty heavy sermon so far. So if you would like, you can take this moment to imagine your Savior Jesus wearing the park ranger uniform with, like, the hat. Yeah. I mean, he's got long hair, so we imagine it's in a ponytail. And so we imagine Jesus, the park ranger uniform, hat, whole kit and caboodle, and he's showing the path to the disciples. The path, he says, is dangerous. The path of Gamaliel is littered with tripping hazards, he teaches them. The path of those in power is a path lined with poisonous plants. The path of religious authoritarianism, it's closed for the winter, guys. Don't even go there.
And so the disciples, clad in their REI gear, they listen to him. They take notes. They believe him. Then he ascends into heaven, and they go forth onto these paths, bringing new friends with them. Don't take these paths, they say, acting just like their ranger. The path that we take is this path that Ranger Jesus Christ taught us. The path of compassion. The path of mercy. The path of peace. The path of hope. The path of Christian community. We take the most beautiful, the most lush, the path shown by Jesus, the path of love. The supplies needed for this path are a willingness to serve those in need, to affirm the dignity of all humans, to erase the forces of oppression, to seek a common harmony for all people without exceptions. That's the path Jesus showed us, and that's the path we're showing you, church. That's what we learned from Acts today. And this path is a gift. We might bucket that. We might look at Jesus, who dies on the hanging tree. We might look at Peter, who tradition tells us also died on a hanging tree. We may look at the 10 of 11 disciples who die as martyrs, according to tradition. We might look at God's children of countless backgrounds today around the world who suffer in their innocence. We may look at this path and say, how in the world are you calling this path beautiful? How in the world is this the most lush, most gifted path? But friends, the Christian path is the most beautiful path because it is a path we tread together. It is the gift in the midst of suffering, of being together. There is unity in our struggle. There is unity in our suffering. As goes the old hymn of Christian community, will you let me be your servant? Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. We are pilgrims on a journey. We are travelers on the road. We are here to help each other walk the mile, bear the load. I will hold the Christ light for you in the nighttime of your fear. I will hold my hand out to you, speak the peace you long to hear. I will weep when you are weeping. When you laugh, I'll laugh with you. I will share your joy and sorrow till we've seen this journey through. When we sing to God in heaven, we shall find such harmony, born of all we've known together, of Christ's love and agony. This is the gift of our life together, all people, unified in our suffering, unified in our love of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Thanks be to God. Amen. Let us declare what we believe using our affirmation of faith from the larger catechism. We are working our way through the Ten Commandments. I will read the leader portion. You are invited to join in the people portion. What is the fourth commandment? The fourth commandment is, remember the Sabbath day to keep it holy. 6 days shalt thou labor and do all thy work. But the seventh day is the Sabbath of the Lord thy God. In it thou shalt not do any work, thou, nor thy son, nor thy daughter, thy manservant, nor thy maidservant, nor thy cattle, nor thy stranger that is within thy gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heaven and earth, the sea and all that is in them, and rested the seventh day. Wherefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and hallowed it. Why is the word remember set in the beginning of the fourth commandment? The word remember is set in the beginning of the fourth commandment, partly because of the great benefit of remembering it. we being thereby helped in our preparation to keep it, and in keeping it, better to keep all the rest of the commandments, and to continue a thankful remembrance of the two great benefits of creation and redemption, which contain a short abridgment of religion, and partly because we are ready to forget the Sabbath. Amen.
Roberta Allison,
She is married to Jeff Allison, who worships here. The two of them will be becoming members here shortly. Well, Roberta, as many of you know, has cancer, and that is why she has not been able to be here with us. And the cancer has spread to multiple organs. And so please, we lift up Roberta in prayer and ask if you would. There are new directories, I believe, are located either downstairs or in the back of the church, maybe in Finley Hall. Her address is in there. If you could send her a card, that would be an incredible blessing, and we would appreciate that. I'm going to come around at this time with the microphone for other prayers. God is good. God hears our prayers. Let us turn to the Lord in prayer. Let us pray. Holy Lord Jesus, you are the love that will not let us go. Wherever we may wander, whenever we walk away from the faith, walk away from your community, when we go and seek our own ways rather than your ways, our own paths rather than your path, your love stays with us. The mark of your love stays. Your love does not let us go. And we give you thanks for that this morning, this holy Sabbath day. God, we give you praise and thanks. We give you thanks that our sister in Christ, Ginny Bowman, is at home. Lord, we give you thanks for all of those who participate in ministries of this church, from the Harvest Festival to the pancake breakfast to caring for our kiddos and children's church, and the many ministries that people don't even know go on here that folks volunteer for. We lift up to you silently now our personal and private prayers of thanksgiving. You be the honor and the praise and the glory, dear God. Even as we have lost count of our blessings, our cup runneth over, we do count amongst those blessings the opportunity to bring our concerns before you, knowing that you listen to the smallest of concerns to the biggest of global concerns with compassion and mercy. We pray this day for those whom we love, for all of those on our prayer list. And we pray for Roberta McIntyre, praying your healing touch upon her. We pray for John Ellis, praying your healing touch upon him, that you would work through their doctors and nurses, that they would receive the very best care possible, Roberta and John. We pray for continued healing for Ginny. And we pray for continued healing for Darlene Farabaugh as she recovers from having her appendix removed. God, we pray that you would grant her your healing touch. We lift up to you now silently our personal, private prayers of intercession. Lord, hear our prayers. Hear us as we pray this day for our mission co-workers, for our sister church in Lichenza, Malawi. Lord, hear our prayer. For Pabotso, our World Vision Child in South Africa. Lord, hear our prayer. For the mission of the Adamses serving at the U.S.-Mexico border. Lord, hear our prayer. We lift up to you all those men and women serving our nation in harm's way, both locally and abroad. Keep them safe, dear Lord. Protect them that they may come home. Be with their families as they wait, and with those they are called to serve. We pray for all of those in positions of leadership in this world. God, we pray for those in leadership locally, but also globally, lifting up before you the nation of Ukraine in these days. And God, we lift up to you the continued reconstruction and recovery in Fort Myers, Florida, as they overcome the damage done by the Hurricane Ian. Go with us into this new week, dear Lord. Guide all that we think, all that we say, all that we do, that in thought, word, and deed we may be so blessed as to glorify you. We pray this in the name of the one who taught us to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Today we will receive our offering in the back of the sanctuary. Amy Riley will have the basket in the back of the sanctuary.
I have been given that honor by Beth, who let me have
it. Well, we appreciate you saying yes. And we can also give online at shupchurch.org. Beloved in Christ, let us say a prayer of dedication over our tithes and our offerings. Let us pray. Holy Lord, receive these, the gifts of our tithes and our offerings. May they be used for the sake of your glory and the sake of your kingdom. Amen. Let us rise as comfortably able for the doxology.
Thank you.
May he guide you through the wilderness, protect you through the storm. May he bring you home rejoicing at the wonders he has shown you. May he bring you home rejoicing once again into our doors.